Well, here we are for Tar Podcast number 32. We've got a little special delight for you. You can't see Mr. Justin. He's behind the camera. I'm in front of the camera. And I have Mr. Shane Van Boening and Mr. Darren Appleton getting ready to match up for Tar 30. This is a 10-ball match. It's been long awaited, and I think it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm not going to be saying too much. I'm going to let these guys do their little spiels for a while. But first of all, I want to say thanks to our sponsors, Kurzweil Meats, Kamui Tips, CSI, and OBQs, and we'll be mentioning them later on as we go through this thing. There was some great response on the AZ thread and some great questions. Justin will be bringing those up a little later. So how are you guys feeling? Just to start things off, you've just been world traveling all over the place.
Yeah, I just got back from China last Wednesday. I should have come back Tuesday, but my flight got cancelled again. So I have had a lot of luck with flights the last maybe three or four trips. I've got cancelled a few times, but that's part of the job. But it didn't cost me anything to stay an extra day, so it's okay.
We have better refs over here than you have over there.
Yeah,
that was a terrible thing. That was ugly.
Yeah, I've been playing pool 20 years, and that's probably the worst experience.
That's terrible. And the fact that you survived it, standing up for you.
You think you've seen it all in pool, but there's always something what pops up. But I've just put it down to experience.
In amateur, I've seen things where you put the patch on the table, and if it's touching the cloth, it doesn't count, and all kinds of crazy things. Yeah. Where'd you come from?
I came from Syracuse, New York.
Turning Stone. Before that?
I was at home fishing for a couple of weeks.
Oh, I saw that too.
Freezing.
Freezing. I'm from Alaska, a few weeks. And we don't ice fish much in Alaska. We're smarter than that. Uh-huh. But me. This is going to be a great match. You know, there's a lot of little things going between you guys. If the Moscone Cup would have gone hill, there was a lot of talk that you guys would have been playing the final game.
Yeah, it was definitely a million percent that it was me and Shane.
See, and that just makes one more level of entertainment here.
We was the only two in the practice room, and it's tough to watch the guys before, because obviously you just want to get it over and done with, because a race to five, anything can happen.
Oh, yeah.
And we had a couple of good matches in the Moscone. I mean, whenever we play each other, we have a lot of good matches.
Yep. Well, there's some history there. So, Justin, why don't I back out and let these guys start talking a little bit? Is that what you want to handle? And keep pushing your questions on to AZ Billiards. We'll be monitoring them. And I want to give you guys both a personal thanks, because people have been waiting to see this one. It's been a while since we've had a tar match. There's a lot of things going on in the world of pool. But this is going to be exciting. And it's a 10-ball, race to 25, 2 out of 3 days. So I'll back out and let Justin take care, and thank you very much.
Okay, guys, everyone, this is Justin with the Action Report. We're going to go through our questions here on the AZ Billiards thread. We'd like to thank everybody at AZ, Mike and Jerry, as well as AccuStats, Pat Fleming, and Jim. They helped us promote this match last week during their Turning Stone stream, and we really appreciate that. Okay, I guess we might as well start off with the first question. This is from Fast Lenny. It's for Darren. People want to know how you aim.
Fast Lenny? Well, aiming can be a tough one. I mean, everyone's got their own little systems and everything else, but I think the top players really go off feel and vision. But I think the first key to aiming is your fundamentals are key. I mean, if your fundamentals are not right, it doesn't matter whatever you do, like, it isn't going to work. So, basically, forget the camera. I basically always try and line up with my cue, with my right leg in a straight line parallel to my cue, and I try and keep the cue like it on the same path as my right foot. So when I get down to the shot, I sort of walk into the shot as well. I never just get down and be off balance. I think it's very important, like, to vision the shot. And then just walk into the shot a little bit, and then just make sure that everything's straight. And, like, I have plenty of room on my right-hand side, and it's bang in line with my foot. And then I just put my left leg forward, maybe like a foot and a half, and then just get down to the shot. And then obviously I'm like vision the shot now. I am picking my point on the ball. For certain shots, like for a rail shot, I do have a little bit of a system called the C system, which you can check out on c-system.com. It's very hard to explain without showing it in person. So I think I would recommend anyone to go on there and check it out. Especially for the rail shots, it helps me a lot for the rail shots. I sort of use the shadow of the balls a little bit, but it's very difficult to explain here. But if you check the website out, I think it's a good help for everyone. So basically, when I get down, I'm just making sure everything's in line, and then I just get down to the shot, and then everything's just coming through nice and straight. And obviously, I think the most important thing is to keep your head still, and just to keep your grip really loose. Because if you get tight on the cue, then you're not timing the ball well. So it's very important, to be loose on the cue. And then just get down and keep everything straight, two or three strokes, and then back, and then just don't really push it, rush your shot, just nice and smooth, nice and back slow, and then through, just like that. So I think everyone's got a different cue action, but your fundamentals are very important, and the setup of the shot, and then the rest just comes down to your feel and your own ability. So systems do help. But I wouldn't 100% work on systems all the time. I'm pretty sure that Shane is the same as well. But there's certain tough shots where I do have a system, especially when I'm under pressure, and especially for the rail shots. And on this table here, the rail shots are going to be key, I think, to this match.
Great, thank you. This is a pretty broad question. It's for both of you. We'll start it with Shane, I guess. What do you attribute much of your success to? Hard work, talent, luck. What's gotten you where you are right now in pool?
For me, it's just a choice for me where I want to be. If I want to be a professional pool player and travel all over the world, and you got to compete in a lot of tournaments. But what got me here today is there's a lot of work ethics, a lot of practice, 10 hours a day, 12 hours a day. I don't know, Darren, you probably put in how many?
Yeah, I mean, over the years, I mean, from the age of 16 to, let's say, 30 years old, I probably practice 5-6 hours a day. And then obviously, as you get older, I think Shane eventually will be the same. When he gets to my age, he'll start cutting it down to 3 or 4 hours a day, but maybe put a lot more quality into your practice. Where the last 2 or 3 years, I practice maybe 2 or 3 hours a day, but 4 or 5 times a week. But obviously, it's difficult because we do a lot of traveling, so we don't get to practice as much as what we would like.
I think that when we were younger, we used to practice.
Yeah, I think when you're younger, you just love the game and you just want to play all the time. You have nothing else to do. And,
yeah. Now when you get older, it's just too much. So, I mean, you got to have something else to do. Yeah. You got to have another hobby. Otherwise, life is too short and you might get bored.
Yeah, but I think that's the main reason why we're successful, because I think when we do practice hard. And I think it's important when you do practice to practice properly. Where I think a lot of amateurs, where they go wrong is that they're just throwing the balls about and they're just potting the balls. I think it's good for you to get in stroke, but after that you need to work on some drills and work on your weaknesses and your strengths. And obviously Shane, he practices break a lot. It's maybe something I need to do as well. But I probably haven't got the patience what he's got with a break. But I have been trying to work on my break a lot more the last couple of years. And it's still not where I want it to be, but I think sometimes I can break good, and I still like to break like Shane. When I first walked in here a couple of days ago, the cloth had just got clothed, and I said to Justin, I said, "What's all these holes here, all these little dints in the table?" He goes, "Oh, Shane's been here." I said, "Oh, he must be breaking good then." It's a brand new cloth.
You know what? My whole table, my table at home, where I have all the tables.
That's amazing.
This whole area right here is covered with white.
Yeah, and if you see these here, these are mine.
And if you see a couple of them here, so the percentage out here is like maybe 95%.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And then the other percent is right outside of the table.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing. I think the reason why I didn't play Shane in the past is because of the break. I just felt my break wasn't anywhere near good enough to compete over a long race.
We played that one match in Derby City, the eight ball match, right?
But I broke pretty good in that match. I just happened to have but we played for 12 hours straight. We start at 10 p.m. and I think we finished at 11 a.m. the next morning with no break and 10 ahead at 8. Well, that was a good match.
Yeah.
Probably one of the best sets I've ever played, really.
I think that was in, 2006, 2007?
2007.
When I won US Open, 2007.
Yeah, I played as good as I could play. I mean, I think I had maybe a 7-pack. I had a 7-pack, 5-pack, but you were getting 8-packs, 9-packs. It was an amazing match. When I look back now, it might be one of the best 8-ball matches of all time.
Look at this.
Yeah.
That one.
Yeah.
Come here, look at this picture.
We're looking
at that. Was it right here.
Oh, yeah, wow, yeah.
That one and that one.
Yeah. There was a lot of money in that match. I mean, we only bet 5,000 of his own money, but I think there was maybe 30,000, 40,000 on the side.
Yeah.
I've got a picture from that match of there was literally so much money hanging on the light.
Yeah, I remember. It was all on the light. There was a big light, and the light was tilted this way.
Yeah, there was so much.
Because, like, when I got beat, I was sort of trying to just tilt it a little bit more and grab a few dollars on my way out. But I was shattered. Straight after that match, I was supposed to play a one-pocket match, but I went to my room to get cleaned up, and I just fell asleep, so I also got scratched from my one-pocket. But that was probably one of the most enjoyable matches I've played. So.
That was a good match. I was there.
But 8-ball was my game anyway, so I knew I had a chance at 8-ball with the patterns and everything. But I mean, we both played great. I mean, people think that Shane's main strength is break. I mean, yeah, he's one of the best breakers in the world. I mean, you got Shane. I think Dennis Orkolo's got a great break now. Chang from Taiwan, Copenyi. I think they're the best four breakers in the world. But there's a lot more to his game now than there was maybe 2 years ago. I think, obviously, he's proved that with the bank pull at Derby and the one pocket. So people just think his break's his main weapon, but he also plays great as well. And
we got more players now than it was a couple of years ago.
Yeah, I think we both improved a lot the last few years.
Yeah,
I mean, I think you was more fearless around 2007. You just didn't care who you played, and but now you sort of learned the game a lot more, and you start to respect the game more as well. And you start getting a few battle scars as well, so it affects us all a little bit with the battle scars. So you sort of can change your game a little bit, and you maybe don't take as many risks as what you did 5 years ago, 4 years ago. But at the end of the day, you still play very positive. And I think the main reason why we're both doing so well, because we're both very competitive, and we both hate to lose, which I think's a good thing. People say I'm a really bad loser, but when I'm playing pool, I feel like I want to kill somebody, but after the match, I'm like just a normal guy. I just go about my business. I'm happy-go-lucky-going guy. And obviously, like I said before, I don't think I was ready to play Shane at 10 ball maybe 3 years ago. Justin asked me a few times. I said, no, I'm not quite ready yet. But now I think I can give him a good game and see what happens.
We had one other question, a bunch of other questions. But let me just get to this. Can you tell people, because there's a lot of, not a lot of people, but there is a misconception out there that your background is that of a snooker player.
Yeah.
And that's not true, is it? What is your background?
Obviously, in the UK, snooker's huge. But back in the early 90s, it was bigger. Snooker was bigger then than it is now. It's still big now, but the prize money back then was crazy. I mean, every tournament was like $150,000 to the winner. The World Championships was like $250,000. But I mean, obviously when I first picked up a cue, I played snooker, but I didn't just play in your local room. And then when I was about maybe 12, I played a little bit of snooker with my dad and my brother, but nothing serious. And then when I got to 15, 16, I got asked to play in practicing in a pub, in a bar, and I got asked to play in their pool team. So that's how I got into pool. So that's when I started playing full time, and I started playing a lot more. And over the years, I've practiced snooker and played local league, but I never even attempted to play play like on the top level or play in the qualifiers to get on the main tour. I just love pool like from day one when I was 15, 16, and I started playing county, which is like over here to be your state team, and then start playing local leagues. When I was 17 to maybe 19, I was playing in maybe six leagues a week I was playing at English 8 Ball, and I just loved the game. I was playing local events all the time. And then the first tournament I ever entered was a junior national event, and I managed to win it. And that sort of made my mind up then that I'm going to be a pool player. And then after 1 year on the main tour, I turned pro at 19. And then I played English 8 Ball up to the age of 30. And the IPT come along. And because it was 8 Ball, I applied to get on the IPT. I managed to get a spot on there. And then obviously after about 6 months, the IPT went tits up. But looking back, it was great for me, the IPT. So I probably owe Kevin a lot for that, because if it wasn't for the IPT, I probably wouldn't be studying now. I'd still be at home playing English 8 Ball and like really struggling to make a living, because there wasn't much money in the game. Like if you made 20,000 a year, you had a good year. You know what I mean? So at least with this game, after the IPT, I had a choice to go back to English 8 Ball or carry on playing American pool. And after playing on that stage, I thought, there's no way I can go back to English 8 Ball. So I started coming to America, spent a lot of time in America, spent a lot of time in the Philippines, because I didn't want to be waiting 3 or 4 years to compete with the best players. So I wanted to try and learn the game as quick as possible, to compete as quick as possible. So my first year of playing American pool, I didn't really play any tournaments. I just spent a lot of time gambling in the Philippines and America. And then around 2008, I started playing on the circuit full time. And then obviously the money games get less and less, and I start focusing more on the competition. So yeah, that's my background really. I mean, a very limited snooker experience. I did practice it. My highest break was 145, but just never really loved the game enough to put them. Because at snooker you have to practice 7 hours a day. There's a difference between snooker and pool. I think pool's more skillful, and there's more shots involved. But with snooker you have to be 100% technique's got to be perfect. So if you're not putting the hours in, you have no chance.
Great, thank you. We've got a couple. This is from Pixies 2. And you guys, he must really want to know this question. He's been a member on AZ Billiards since September of 2005, and he used his 14th post ever to ask this question. Mm-hmm. Please get them to shoot their favorite shots at the table and perhaps shots they dislike as well. So Shane, while you set up, what's your favorite shot?
The break.
And don't do a pinball 4 feet from the corner.
Well, I guess favorite shot to, you know, just to get in stroke. I guess that's what he's asking, right?
Yeah, what's your favorite shot?
To me, I like to do this shot here. Just shoot this ball and shoot it straight
can you
back.
Turn around and shoot it this way towards me?
Yes. I'll line it up corner to corner. And this is just a shot for me to get in stroke for draw shots. Because you really have to work on it to get a real good straight line. And I just try to draw it back in here.
So
that's just for me to get
in stroke
for a draw shot. You know, for a high shot, for a lot of high shots like this, you got to draw the cue ball.
So you have to work on your stroke just to make sure it's straight?
Yeah, it'll tighten up your stroke and get in stroke, and you'll be prepared more.
Darren, how about you? And then we'll get into what shots you guys hit.
Pretty much similar. I mean, I do it a little bit easier than Shane, because to me, when I think when you practice, for example, a lot of competitions we play, we don't get a lot of time to practice. So I just like to keep it simple and try and get a feel for the shot. Not like too easy, but similar to Shane, really. Just I try and make the nine ball, and I just try and keep everything straight. Because if you're not cueing the ball good, then you're going to miss it to the left or right. There's something wrong here. So, but if you're cueing it straight, then it's going to come back in a straight line like Shane. But I just try and draw the white ball back to here. So then it's all about timing and feel. So just sort of similar, really, just keep everything simple and just try and get a feel for the shot, because if you're not timing the ball well, then you don't get the cue ball where where you want it to land, then you're going to be in trouble when it comes to the game. So just maybe play like 10 or 20 of these type of shots and just drawing the cue ball back to here just to get a nice feel for the shot and the and whether you're hitting the ball good or not. Like there, I hit the ball quite easy, so that means I'm cueing okay today. Where if you're not, then you probably stop it dead or you overdraw the ball. So just maybe 10 or 20 shots of them type of shots are good, like, for your feel and stroke.
Okay. Shane, what shot do you not like?
The shots I don't like, I don't like the rail shot, pretty much. Like this shot here.
Flip around the other way. Shoot this towards the center. There you go.
If the cue ball's floating on the rail. And if it's straight in like that, I don't really like it, but I gotta roll the ball in. I can't hit it hard. A lot of players like to hit it hard sometimes, but I gotta roll it in like this. That's the only way for me to make it.
Yeah.
But sometimes I need a little bit more stroke to get in shape.
Well, I think that's a tough shot for everybody. I mean,
I can't.
Some players are great at rolling balls and some players are not. I mean, that's definitely not one of my strengths. But someone like Ralph Suke is amazing at these type of shots.
I mean, I think Earl will make it pretty good.
Earl, yeah.
If you hit it hard.
Yeah, Earl may fire it in.
Earl will fire it in and draw back, and Larry Neville.
I can't really do it, but.
Hopefully you don't make a few of them tomorrow.
That's a shot I hate the most.
What about you, Daz?
Yeah, I think for me, I think because I'm quite short and my fingers are quite small. At English 8 ball, I used to be pretty good at these type of shots because the balls like are smaller and the table's smaller. But on here, I sort of struggle with these sort of bridge shots. So, and it happens a lot where you like play a shot and you get unlucky like and you land in front of the ball. And then obviously, if I can see the four ball, we out the white bulb in there, it's a pretty simple pop, but obviously your mindset now is thinking, wow, I've landed there and it's a really tough shot. And I think because I've got small hands, it's difficult for me to really sight the ball. I've like tried different things. But if I land like this and I'm thinking this is a really tough shot. But if you're tall, I think it's a lot better if you're tall. So I think this is like a disadvantage for me, bridging over balls. So, especially when you got to do something with a cue ball as well. You know what I mean? I think it's a tough shot for anybody, but I think that's a big disadvantage for me because I'm quite short and my fingers are small.
Lucky so, I got big fingers.
It's okay, you got big fingers. But I tried to get some of them things what Earl got,
them extensions,
but they banned them. but yeah, I'd say they're one of the toughest shots in the game. But some players playing really good and other players don't.
Okay, here's some questions from Nick B. This is for each guy. If you couldn't play in Tar 30, but you were allowed to put someone in your place for the money, who would you put up? Shane, if you couldn't play, who would you put in against Darren?
An active player today, not a Moscow
or anything
like that.
I have to say Dennis Okolo.
Orcola? Daz, what about you?
Yeah, I mean... Yeah,
Dennis Orcola?
We all have to pick Dennis. No, I think in current form on the worldwide stage is his most consistent player. So, and I think he's like me and Shane. He puts a lot of work in. And I think it's fair to say, even though I'm not one like for bullying myself up, really. But I mean, the last 4 years, 5 years, if you look at the results, I think us three have had the most success out of all the players in the world. Competition-wise, I think we probably won the most tournaments between us. So, yeah, I mean, I put Dennis in. But there's a bunch of other guys as well. I mean, Alex plays great, and Buster Manti, and Chang, and all them guys. But I think Dennis is currently the man to beat, especially playing Tembo.
Okay, he's got another question here. What accomplishment is on your bucket list? I'm assuming he's talking about pool. Is there something out there you want to do in the game that you haven't done yet?
Well, at English 8 ball, I won everything at English 8 ball, and I was world number one for maybe 6-7 years, but I never won the World 8 ball championship, lost in the final twice, and the American 8 ball world championship, I've lost in the semi-final twice, so I think if I could pick one title to win, it would be the World 8 ball championship.
Jay?
I'd like to win a tournament overseas, a world championship overseas, 9 ball or 8 ball.
Why? This comes up sometimes. When you play in the United States, you just won the U.S. Open, you just won Turning Stone, you slayed Derby City last year. I mean, you're playing some of the same guys, but what reason do you give for not so far, you know, winning an international tournament? You play a lot of them.
It's just different. You're meeting different cultures. You're eating different foods. Darren, you probably had trouble eating different foods.
Yeah, obviously, when you first go to Asia, it's tough.
You know, you don't feel like you're home, and it feels like you're on a different planet. Really.
Yeah, but I think the big difference for you is that Paul was born in America. I mean, so you've lived your whole life in America, and you probably didn't have a passport till like 5 years ago, and so most of your tournaments in your career has been played in America. And for a long time, America was the best country at pool. So it's slightly tougher for Americans, I think, than it is for guys from Europe. Because we've always sort of had to travel because there isn't much pool in Europe. So, I mean, someone like Ralph Suke, I mean, he I don't think it matters to him whether he's in Asia, Europe or America. He just feels the same. And, I mean, it's slightly easier for the European guys, I'd say, to travel than it is the American guys, just because we probably travel more and we've had more experience with the travel. So we sort of work his way around the food and all that stuff. And to be honest, like, the food's not very good in England anyway, and the water, so it makes no difference to us. But obviously, the big thing is to get over the jet lag, for me personally. But obviously, Shane, I think he struggles. You've been sick a few times with water and foods. So I think he needs to try and get a better balance with what he eats and drinks when he goes abroad. But it's quite surprising that he hasn't won tournaments abroad, especially with the way he plays in America. I'm not saying I don't think he's played bad abroad. I think just haven't played his 100% game on a consistent level. And obviously the competition's tougher as well. I mean, you need some luck to win abroad. I mean, there's no doubt about that. Whoever you are, any big tournament you win, you need a little bit of luck along the way.
Okay, there was another question. This might be, you know, based on what you both have won to date, your records so far, and you're both really only about 5 or 6 years into your career, I mean, for the most part, which is pretty crazy when you consider what you guys have both won. Yeah. If you didn't play another tournament, do you think you would be in the Hall of Fame?
I don't know.
Or does that even, do you ever think about, does that
yeah,
ever cross
obviously,
your mind?
After you've won a few big tournaments, you start thinking of that, and you see a few players get inducted. I mean, it's probably your dream, really, when you set out playing. I mean, when you start doing it for a living, you're thinking, well, I'd love to get in the Hall of Fame, because it's like such a bit, like, I think it's like the pinnacle of any pool player with any goals. So yeah, of course you think about it. The only thing I would love to get in. I think maybe I've done enough, I'm not sure. I mean, there's some players who are not in who I'm really surprised not in, like Jose Perica. I was like flabbergasted that he's not in the Hall of Fame. That I really couldn't get my head around that one, because he's won 29 competitions around the world. I mean, big time. He won a world championship in 1988. So that really surprised me. So I don't think it's a given for any of us, but obviously Shane being an American and is dominated in America. I think the American results play a bigger part for the Hall of Fame than it does abroad, because there's a lot of great players abroad who probably don't come to America, and they'll never get recognised, I don't think. So I think Shane's absolute certainty. Maybe I've got a good chance, hopefully, one day. But the only thing I would disagree with the Hall of Fame is that I think it should be something what you get given towards the end of your career, where at the moment I'm like thinking I've only really been playing 5 years, and I'm 37 in a couple of weeks. So I think you've got to be 40 years old.
40 years old before you can be considered.
To get an opportunity, I'm thinking, well, I mean, I take it if it comes, but I'm thinking I'm only just really in the middle of where I want to be. You know what I mean? So people like Ralph, I think they might have got inducted a little bit too early, because I think mentally it can play a big thing on your mind, thinking it's something that you should be getting towards the end of your playing career.
That's been a big debate for many years.
I think maybe like 45, 50 is a good age.
Yeah, 50 would make sense to me.
Yeah.
You've got Shane. What do you think? Hall of Fame? Have you ever thought about it? I mean, does it cross? Have you ever crossed your mind, or do you just?
For me, it's just another tournament goes by, and then you move on to another tournament. So, I mean, I'm not really interested in Hall of Fame yet.
Yeah. But so, when he gets to 60 years old, he'll look back and he'll think, wow.
Yeah.
How old are you now?
It's definitely something you look back when you're
How old are you now, Shane?
29.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you both got a lot of years left.
Yeah.
Well. I got one question. Is Buddy Hall in the Hall of Fame?
Yeah, many years ago, 15 years ago, something like
that. So the reason why I'm not interested in the Hall of Fame is that because I hear a lot of people saying that they don't know who Buddy Hall is. I mean, once you're in the Hall of Fame, then what? You know, a lot of people are going to forget about you, and they don't know who you are. All the young people, they don't know who the old-timer players are. They don't know who Buddy Hall is. They don't know who...
That's the evolution of the game, and it's really been weak the last few years, unfortunately. Mm. There's so many things to do. Kids today play computer games and things like that. It's our job to bring the visibility back, and that's what TAR and some of the things we do is all about. You know, because we think that everybody should know who you guys are.
Yeah.
And you should be on TV and ESPN, well, on the news and stuff.
When I started playing American Pool in 2006, I'd never heard of Buddy Hall. I'd never heard of him, because he never played in the Moscow County Cup.
Yeah.
And that is the only thing I watched on television.
Well, actually, didn't he play the Moscow County Cup way back, like year one
no,
or two?
He never played it.
Really?
Which amazed me, like, because obviously you find out what he's achieved and everything else, and it's quite a shock, really. I mean, Paul doesn't get the recognition it deserves, and like Shane's. I think it's something, when you get older, it's great to look back and tell your grandkids or your kids that, look... I achieved something.
Yeah.
All right. We're half an hour into the podcast here, and I want to take a minute to tell everyone about something that Chris Kurzweil at Kurzweil's Meats put together for us. And it's the TAR Action Pack. You can check this out. It's a let me put this up. This is a little better picture. There we go. It's $50. You get two packages of brats, your choice. One of maple cured bacon, sausage, chops, grillers. Anybody that hasn't had Kurzweil stuff really should check it out. It's only $50. Mention TAR, you get 10% off. And it is really some amazing, amazing stuff.
Yeah, it's some pretty good stuff.
Go ahead and check them out. Website's there. It's on our Facebook. I'll get it up on our webpage as well, too. And just wanted to mention our other sponsors as well. We've got Kamui Tips, which, Shane, are you playing with the Kamui still?
Yeah.
Which one do you play with?
Kamui Brown Medium.
Medium. Did you used to play with a hard?
You know, every time when I put a tip on, they tell me they put on a hard, and I can't really tell. I don't think there's much of a difference between medium and hard. So I think they're pretty close. So a lot of times they put it on hard, and I'm using hard. Well, this one right now I'm using medium.
Okay. And then our other sponsor, longtime sponsor, is OBQs. You'll see them. They're going to have some new stuff out at Super Billiards Expo this year. And then OB signed... Well, Alex, our buddy.
That's true.
Player rep.
They're actually going to be here tomorrow, too.
Oh, yeah.
Don and Royce.
Oh, outstanding.
Alex?
They'll be right here.
Really?
No, Don and Royce.
Don and Royce.
The sponsors.
Not Alex.
The OBQ guys.
And we have the aforementioned Kurzweil's Country Meats. Just good stuff, man. Check it out. Everything they do is amazing. And as always... Q Sports International, and we've got the Swanee coming up here Next weekend?
No, you're a month off.
Oh, okay. Derby's next week.
February 23rd and 24th is the Swanee in L.A. at Hard Times. And then the 25th of February through March 2nd or 3rd is the U.S. Bar Table Championship. And people have asked, you can get in both of them. Don't worry about it. If you get deep in Sunday, you're good for Monday. But these are both pretty good events, especially for the West Coast. 25,000 added at the bar table. In fact, we're probably going to see Shane at the bar table.
I'm there.
Really? Well, good. See,
I have a week off that week.
We don't know what the schedule is on bonus ball, so we don't know who's going to be there. But it's a 9-hour drive or an hour flight, and it's pretty good money. Tar's going to be up there. We're going to do some streaming. And
I played there 2009.
Yes, you did. I remember that.
I enjoyed it.
You played Earl in the finals, and
I played twice. I played Shane in the 9-ball 1 year, but that Glenn Atwell, he finished second in two of them and first in the other. So he beat me.
Kinda.
I get two finals and a third, and I finished second in the all round.
<That's>
amazing. Glenn Atwell, he played good on the bar table. That guy.
He did real well.
But and then he won it the last 2 years, I think.
That bar table is a beast.
It's a good game.
We got another question here for Shane.
A lot of fun.
Being back-to-back one-pocket champ at Derby City, how do you think you would do in a headset with Scott Frost?
One pocket?
One pocket. I played him a year ago, or a year and a half ago.
He was here, right, at the Q Club?
That was at the Pool Sharks.
Pool Sharks.
And we played for 24 hours straight.
Wow.
And that was like the best experience I ever had. And that's why my one pocket game is on another level today. So how I think I do with Scott, I think I need a ball with him.
He says that to everybody.
He's definitely one of the best one pocket
players.
I
think
out
with
there.
Scott Frost, you're best playing him over a short set, like a 5 ahead, 6 ahead. Because once he gets his stroke loose and he's confident, then he's an amazing shot maker.
He's got some serious firepower.
But if you keep him tight and under pressure, then I like Shane in the game. Well, I don't think there's much in it. I mean, everyone's got a different style.
Okay, here we go. This is from your buddy Chris Bartram. For both players, if you don't win the tar match, which now is a free roll, does it hurt like a loss in a gambling match, or is this more of a fun set for you? Basically, he wants to know if you care as much about this as you do if you're gambling.
To me, it's just a loss of a gambling match.
Same?
I take it more serious.
What's that, gambling match or this?
It's more like a gambling match, so.
Yeah,
I've been waiting to play for...
Is there any real difference between
a
gambling match?
I mean, if I could win this match, I wouldn't be here. I don't care about... the money's nice, it's a bonus, but to me, it's about competing and winning. And I want to be able to compete, and I believe I can compete. So, it's just... I want to win badly, and obviously, if I lose, I'll be disappointed. But I know I'm up against it. But I like the challenge, and obviously, if I lose, I'll be just as disappointed as what I would if I was staking 20,000 my own money.
Well, that's the professionalism of these two guys too.
Well, I think
because your attitude.
I think the guys who are coming through in the game now, especially the last 4 years, there's no cheating them. There's no sharking. I mean, the good guys who are coming into the game, and we all want to win really badly. Whether we're playing for $10 or $100, we all want to win. We all have a little bit of an ego, which is a good thing as long as it's healthy. And we all want to beat each other. I mean, it's nice to compete against the best players in the world. And obviously, I'm very excited about
it. Well, a lot of times you're competing with yourself, too.
Yeah.
You want to make sure you can show up.
Yeah, of course. I mean,
that was a good question.
That was a good question.
Here we go. This is from OR1PKT, OR1 Pocket. Shane playing as strong as he is right now. I would like to know if he feels he has any weak parts of his game or things he practices more than others?
I just feel that I practice more than others. I feel like I'm more dedicated to the game, like Earl. I say Earl's like the most dedicated person in the pool.
Is there anything you practice more? Is there something you work on specifically? You feel like you got a weak part of your game?
It'll come up when I practice. So, I mean, every time when I practice and I see something that I miss, then I'll work on it. And that's what I work on. Something that's difficult for myself. Some shots that come up a lot, and I just got to work on it.
Show us a shot. Show us something else that you would work on. We've got you guys around this table.
Like a lot of times...
Shoot the other end and shoot okay. This way.
Like a lot of times, this shot come up a lot. You got to shoot balls back here. You got to roll the ball in. And I'll work on this for 2 or 3 hours straight if I have to.
Just rolling those balls in.
Yeah. A lot of times you got to roll the balls in. And I'll just work on it. I think that's important. Because a lot of times you got to roll the balls in the pocket.
Okay. Daz, what about you? Is there any weak part of your game or is there a part you focus on?
Yeah, obviously. I think compared to the very best players, I think I probably weak. My break's probably slightly weaker than most of the top players. But I think the problem for me is that I'm from Europe and we use the cup break a lot. So that sort of goes against me a little bit, where in America they're always used to breaking the balls really hard and everything else. So I've never really had to do that. So. I sort of have to switch a lot from like breaking hard to cup breaking hard to cup breaking, where the last week or so I just get to practice my 10 ball break and I feel it's coming on nice. So I like to work on my break when I can, but only when I have to. I mean, the pool world's weird because we're playing different games all the time. We're playing 9 ball, probably 60% in Europe and Asia we're playing 9 ball, and it's cup break or the matchroom events, for example. So our cup break probably as good as anybody, but... I'd like to work on my harder break, like 10 ball, a lot more. So that's one thing I like to work on when I get the opportunity. And then just like Shane, really, like rail shots. I mean, virtually every rack you play in 9 ball or 10 ball, you're going to have something like this, these type of shots all the time. Like, you're always going to have to, 80, 90% of the time, every rack you play, you're going to have a rail shot. And they're always the tricky ones, you know what I mean? So obviously I'll just work on these type of shots, work like Shane, and just come. I like to pot it and come across twice for the same rail. Like I can make the six come across twice, just to get a feel for how the cue ball reacts, and obviously get the sighting. And also I play it and just come across this way, just with a little bit of draw, because these shots happen a lot in matches. So they're the things I like to work on in practice, and even like. Do like simple drills, but if you put the hours in, because you have a lot of situations like this, and I think it's very important that any pool player who's looking to come into the game, it's important to work on the aspects of the game, what happens a lot, show up a lot in the games, and work on your weaknesses.
Mark, can you walk over and hit that space bar on that computer to turn that back on? Try the mouse pad. There you go. That's good. Thank you. What else we got here?
Well, along that same line, maybe ask them, what have you learned from other players? What's the one thing from playing? Like you mentioned you learned a lot from Scott playing.
From when I watch other players, a lot of times I like to watch Earl. I mean, I watch him practice, and I see some shots that he does, you know. I think part about his game is that his game is very powerful on the table, that he do a lot of draw shots. I mean, he's very straight shooter, and that's what I learned from players. I learned by watching other players and see how they hit the ball right.
Yeah, you can learn the shots or the techniques for the strategy. I know you're a big Earl fan, and I think everybody's a big Earl fan. Yeah. I mean, he's been a force for many years.
Yeah, I mean, Earl might be the greatest 9-ball player of all time. Yeah. He's definitely up there. There's no doubt about that. I mean, to win 5 U.S. Opens, is it?
Yeah, 5.
5 world 9 balls. I mean, crazy, really. I mean, it doesn't matter whether there's 60 players in it or 200 players in it. I mean, it's an incredible record. And in the U.K., he's the most famous pool player in the U.K. Because in the Moscone Cup days and the world 9 ball days,
oh, yes.
Matchroom, he was front page headlines. because there was drama all the time. So it was all over the news channels. It was the only time Poole got a lot of publicity, and it was because of him, not because of Davis. It was because of Earl.
That's interesting.
But back then, he was playing his best game back them days. I mean, it was.
Well, he can still play his best game, just not for as long.
When he played Bustamante in that final, when he hit that gear, it was unbelievable. I mean, some of the shots but Earl's biggest weakness is his focus. He beat himself nine times out of ten. But then you got on the other scale, you got someone completely the opposite, who might not be the best, prettiest player to watch, but probably the most controlled and the perfect professional in Ralph Souquet. I mean, you can learn a lot from that guy. Niels Fiennes, another one is like Shane. Niels is the most dedicated pool player, except for Shane. He's so driven and dedicated, and he practices every day. He goes in the gym every day. I mean, you can learn a lot from them guys. I think Mika had 2 or 3 years where he was like super focused and practicing all the time. Since then, I think he's been spending too much money. and then obviously you got Dennis. I think Dennis really puts the hours in. I like to learn off the Filipinos for the kicking and the safety and the like percentage of their kicking. There's always a reason why they're playing it with draw, or whether they're playing it with a bit more English. Than
a lot of finesse.
Well, I think the European guys and the American guys, we used just worry about hitting the ball and just getting a good contact. But with the Filipinos, they're trying to create something, but they're always hitting the ball the right way. Like, they might go the most difficult way to hit the ball, but it makes sense. So when I spent time in the Philippines, I was thinking, why is it going that way when it's like such an easy hit off one rail, but they'll go off like three rails. But when they hit the ball, they're giving themselves the best chance to get it safe. Whereas right. If you just play like the one rail, they have virtually no chance to get it safe. So you learn a lot of stuff like that off Efren especially, and Alex, I think Alex, very underrated kicker, Alex, in my opinion.
And an underrated banker. We saw that when he played Shane.
After Efren, I think Alex has got the best safety game in the world. And then obviously Dennis has got good safety game, Ronnie Alcano, Bustamante. And obviously Shane's improved his a lot. I think I've improved mine a lot. But you have to, if you're going to compete at the top level, you've got to have a good safety game. So it's like I go back to before with Shane's break. I mean, forget about his break. If he can't kick good and play safe good and make the balls under pressure, then you can have the best break in the world. It's not going to get you very far.
You mentioned something about the Philippines, and that brings up another question here. It's from JB Cases. The question was for Shane. If you had $100,000 to gamble with, and you spent 3 months in the Philippines and 3 months in Taiwan / China, which is also known as Taina, and took on all comers, even any table, any location, do you think you would be ahead after 6 months?
Yeah.
There you go.
Short and sweet.
If I'm going to spend 6 months and gamble with $100,000, yeah, I'll be ahead.
There you go. Darren, how about you, pal?
Well, I did spend maybe 6 months of 2007 in the Philippines, and I come away with about $15,000 profit. And at that time, it was, when I look back now, I think it was a miracle, because I wasn't playing Efren or Dennis, but I was playing Gomez, Jeff DeLuna, Warren Kayamko, Gabika. And at that time, it was equivalent to me playing Efren now or Bustamante now. So, yeah, I'd like to think I'd come away, yeah. Because, like, if I play 50 matches, I would like to think I'm going to win 26 out of the 50. I think you're always going to lose matches, but you're going to win matches. So I think if you're playing, like, 50 different guys with 100,000, you'd like to think you're going to win more than you lose. So I'd say, yeah, I probably like my chances of coming away winning, but I wouldn't be surprised if we lost either.
Yeah, you stayed in the Philippines after the World Championship in 2007. Is that when you went over there?
No, 2006. At the end of 2006.
Okay.
And then I stayed for about 6 months in 2007. And when I look back now, I was playing games what I shouldn't be playing, but I wanted to play.
Well, that's how you learn, too.
I had no fear, because I just wanted to enjoy the game, learn off the guys I'm playing. I mean, I learned a lot of... I played Warren Kamko maybe 6 times, and we were playing big sets, and Jeff DeLuna and all them guys, Gomez, I were playing big sets, and Cortese, I beat Cortese. That was probably at that time my biggest win, because he's one of the best players. And I was winning most of them games. I mean, when I look back now, I think, it was crazy to play them to play them guys then. I mean, even now I can lose to them now. I mean, but back then I wasn't supposed to win. So I think the Philippines respected me for what I did there. And yeah, but when you're in that getting that gambling mode, you're sort of ready for it. But these days, gambling's changed a lot because now you have a lot of stream, a lot of matches are pre-arranged, so you have a lot more time to prepare. So it's a bit different gambling, I think, the last 2 or 3 years compared to back in like 5 or 6 years ago and beyond that.
Yeah.
Here's a question that a lot of people, and I've always had the belief that at the level you guys play at, the game is 90% mental, because you guys all, you know, the top 20 guys all play the same. They all, nobody shoots any better than anyone else. So it's majority of it's mental. And so what do you do to prepare yourself mentally for a big tournament, a big match, something like that? Is there a routine you go through, or do you just try to stay loose and then focus when you get in? You know, like, I mean, tomorrow is a big match, but you both, you know, Shane, is there anything you do before something like when you played at the U.S. Open Finals this year?
More importantly, for me, is you got to practice on the table that you're going to play on. You got to stay in stroke. And then make sure you eat right.
Yeah.
Don't eat too much. To me, I just think about the times, like when I played in the U.S. Open last year in the finals, I just think of a time when I played Ronnie Alcano in the finals. I'm in the same spot. So I just think of that time and think how good I played there. And that's what I did.
Just visualize a little bit, huh?
I just visualized that time in 2007.
Wow. Okay. What about you, Des?
Yeah, it's like you said, I think there's maybe 20 players who play to the same level, ability-wise, and making the balls. I mean, there's maybe 30, 40 guys who make the balls just as good as each other. But it's like you say, it all comes down to the mental aspect of the game. And me and Shane spoke about this last night, actually, and the best players are mentally the strongest, and they do prepare the best, and they're the best under pressure. Because we all can make balls in practice under, with no pressure, but when the pressure's really on, then I think that's what separates the great players from the really good players. And luckily, I've been able to make a few balls under pressure when I've really had to. But I'm like Shane, really. I mean, the bigger the stage, the better I feel in myself. And I mean, you still have the pressure and the nerves, but it's more excitement. You're excited to be there, and you want to like perform to your best. And like I said, like when. When I do get to the finals, I think to myself, there's nothing for second, really. You know, it's nice to get to the final, don't get me wrong, but losing's... Because nobody remembers second place. And there's a lot of players who were quite happy to finish second. But it's nice to get in that position. If everyone said to me, I'll always finish second, I'd probably take it because you're winning money all the time. But really, deep down, I'd rather win one or two big events a year than losing the finals all the time. I mean, so when I get to the finals, I'm sort of going to my own little zone. And like Shane, I use my experiences from the past. Like, for example, like when I beat Corey in the US Open, the following year I play Sean. I think right, just make sure I've got the same mindset. And the same in the World Nine Ball this year. Even the match was 12-12. I was thinking when I played Wu Chia Ching in the World Ten Ball, and it was like Ill Hill, and I'm thinking, oh. I did it then, so I can do it now, you know what I mean? So you, every match and every situation is a different sort of pressure, but experience is big, and being able to handle the pressure is key. I think the biggest respect for I got for Shane is that I played him in the Moscone Cup, just gone, and I played amazing to beat him 5-0. So, and I draw him the next day, and I'm thinking, oh, it's a good time to play him. You know what I mean? Because I've really put a scare on him. And then he beat me 5-1. So that shows the character of him. I mean, it could have been easy for him like to be lacking in confidence. And but he's like thinking, right, I want to get my own back. You know what I mean? So that's what makes the great players, I think.
Well, you guys have got a good rivalry, and it's respect also.
Yeah,
and that's good.
I've never had a problem with him. When I mean, the last 12 months we play a lot of finals. And Shane said to me at the bar in Vegas after the US Open One Pocket that me and him might play in the most finals in the next 3 or 4 years. So I think it's good because when we play each other,
well, that's good.
when we play each other, we never speak, and we want to win really badly. But off the table, we've got a good relationship. I think I've got to know Shane more in the last 2 years and before. Before I thought he didn't really want to speak and blah blah blah. But I think he come out of his shell a lot more, and he's a nicer guy than what people think. So, we have a good relationship.
Well, I don't know about that.
I mean, I have a lot of respect for him, and anybody what puts the work in like he does and has a success, it's difficult to not respect that. And but I think we'll have a lot of good battles, hopefully, in the next few years.
Yeah, next 20 years or so.
Yeah, but we just need to get rid of Dennis Orcolo and one or two other guys.
We've got some questions here from Jay Hansen. Keith Hansen, I think is his name. I don't know. Anyway, he wants to know if either of you would be interested in playing an all-around competition. I mean, you guys are both play. You're both all-around players. I mean, you play all games. Darren, do you play Banks at all?
I try.
A derby? Yeah.
I don't get to play enough. I mean, we only play at the Derby and Tunica, so it's twice a year.
I mean, you're a great one-pocket player.
Twice
a year.
I mean, I'm okay at the bank pool. I'm probably not as patient at bank pool as what I should be. I need to be more patient. I sort of lose my... it's my least favourite game, let's say. I'm very impatient with bank pool. It's okay if you're making the banks and it's going well, but when you start missing easy ones, then I get frustrated, but... It is something I'm going to try and work on for this year, because if you're going to win the all-round at Derby, you've got to do good in all the events. And the bank pool, I think my best result, I finished, 12th. I got to round 10 1 year. So I'd like to at least get to round 9 or 10, because then it sets you up good for the one pocket and the nine ball. So I think one pocket, I'm getting close to the top guys. I can definitely beat all of them over a short race. Me and Shane have a couple of good matches at the US Open. So, I mean, one pocket, eight ball, nine ball, straight pull, I'm comfortable. Bank pull, probably yep. Give that one a miss at the moment. But.
And then here's a question, same guy. Darren, you're playing bonus ball. Shane, you chose not to play. He'd like to hear why you each made the choice you did regarding bonus ball. Like, why did you choose to play bonus ball?
For me, obviously, I moved from England to America. And when I sort of got asked to play, I looked at the possibility of the schedule, and I said to the guys, look, I might not as make all the matches, but... And I wasn't going to play. Maybe 3 months ago, I wasn't going to play because it sort of didn't work out with my schedule. But then Stevie Moore sort of begged me to play because he is in my team, and I said to him, I don't think I'm going to play. He's sort of like begging me to play. And then when I looked at the schedule... But then they changed the dates. So it both started in November. So when I looked at the schedule again, I thought, oh, it works out good, the schedule, because around Christmas, January, February, March, there isn't a lot going on, really, except for, like, local tournaments. So I thought, yeah, I can probably make 15, 16 out of the 22 weeks. So, and I like the idea of Vegas. It's something I probably always wanted to, deep down, I think, I've always wanted to come in and probably base here. Coming, like, from the UK, I mean, it's difficult to find a good base where you feel happy and comfortable, and I think I feel happy in Vegas. And I've got to know a lot of people here. So if the bonus ball was in a different country, I don't think I'd play. But obviously it's in America and that's where I've moved to. So there's no reason for me to not play, really. And it's working. I just hope the schedule works out and I can make as many matches as possible. And I like, also I like the team concept. So I like team play.
Shane, why did you choose to take a pass, at least this first season?
I decided to stay home, and I think it's taken too much time, taking a toll on my life.
Yeah.
I'd be more comfortable if I can go to one tournament a month. I'd be more happy to do that. Okay. And that's all I wanted. So I don't want to be on the road for 300 days a year.
Yeah. So are you going to slow down this year? Because I know in the past 5 years you've traveled, it's been ridiculous, your schedule. Are you going to slow down a little more this year? You're just going to do the same thing?
You might have to. There's no tournament.
It's hard to say. I mean, it's just depending on how much income I make a year. You know, there's goals where I want to be, and there's you know, there's a lot of decisions I got to make for myself, but I'm trying not to take a toll on my life.
Yeah, you could. I think someone like Ralph Suke is a great example. I think he travels too much. I think there's traveling and there's traveling, but I think, in my opinion, he burns himself out a lot because he's going to tournaments where there's no rankings involved, where maybe $2,000-$3,000 to the winner in Paris or wherever. I mean, no disrespect to them competitions, but to me, I like to work myself up for the big tournaments, like the major championships, like Shane. So I think me moving to America has sort of helped me because playing the bonus ball as well, because now I've committed to not playing on the Euro Tour. I won't play any tournaments in Europe. Maybe only one tournament I play in Europe, and that will be the World 10 Ball is going to be in Norway, I believe. So that's the only tournament I will probably play in Europe this year. So obviously all the rest of my time is going to be in America. So I haven't got to worry about travelling back and forth. So I think this schedule helps me a lot. It's made my mind up what I want to do. Because I don't want to travel as much as what I have been doing the last 4 years. Right. I think last year I had 67 flights.
Yeah. Travelling will, it'll beat you up.
And it catches you up. I want to commit to the big WPA tournaments and the invitation tournaments like Guinness. Guinness do a great speed pool tournament, and China have some good tournaments, Japan. And I enjoy going to some countries for them tournaments, Philippines. And so that I want to sort of reserve my energy for them big tournaments and then just play as many tournaments in America.
Okay, this is a good question. Each of you, where is your favorite place to play? Like, if you could play pool anywhere, country, pool room, whatever. Just where do you really enjoy playing pool? Or Shane, go ahead.
I gotta be pick Derby City.
Yeah.
I mean, just for, if there's one place, it would be Derby City, like, you know, one tournament a month for 10 days. Mm. I'll be happy.
Guys, what about you?
Well, I think everyone has their favourite venue. Like Shane, is unbelievable what he's achieved at the Derby. I guess the old venue at the US Open would be mine. The old venue, the Conventional Centre, I really like that venue a lot. I think it's a good arena to play. I think you like it there also. The US Open, the previous venue. But I also love coming to Las Vegas, even though, like, we don't have a Pacific venue. The back room at the Riviera. But I love coming to Las Vegas to play. I think so that's my favourite city, is Las Vegas. And I'd probably say the Philippines. But I think if you could have, like, maybe 600 people and you're playing, like, for example, if me and Shane played in the Moscone Cup, at 10-10 at the York Hall, I think that would have been amazing. Yeah. Even though I'm sort of glad Nick won, in the back of my mind, I was thinking it would have been a great experience to play the match at 10-10 because that would have been the ultimate pressure. And in that atmosphere, I think you can't beat that atmosphere. And the venue's got something about it.
Yeah. Oh, sure it does.
So I think the best venue to play in a team would be York Hall, and singles, I'd say the US Open at the old venue.
This is a question for me. What was your biggest win for you personally?
I think my biggest win and the most important was winning the World 10 Ball against Wu Chia-Ching. Because at that time, for me, he was probably the best player in the world at that time, 2008. And like the previous year, he won like the World 8 Ball, World 9 Ball. And nobody gave me a chance in that match. So, and I played really good. And it was in the Philippines. So, and that opened a lot of doors for me because I'd never won a world championship. So it was sort of like a relief and a lot of joy and a lot of emotion. Like, I remember the phone call to my mum and dad. And I've never experienced that phone call ever since then, even when I've won US Opens, World 9 Ball, US Open. So I say the World 10 Ball is the most important. But if I could pick one title to win it, it's probably the World 9 Ball.
Shane, what about you? Was it the first U.S. Open?
I think it was the first U.S. Open when I beat Ronnie Alcano in the finals. Yeah. Other than that, I would have to pick Derby City last year when I got in the finals in all three tournaments.
Yeah.
I don't know how I did it, but I
want to ask you both. There's a question here about road stories, and it brings me up something, you know, and Daz mentioned it when he first saw me when he came in. you know, Chad Pullman passed away this year, and all three of us were good friends with Chad. And Daz, I know he loved you. I mean, he was ever since that first, you know, you and Carl came up in Derby and hung out with us that first year. But if you guys can, if you can think of like a, and chances are it would be a funny story. But Shane, why don't you tell a story about Nasty that you remember either? Because I've got, when you get done, I'm going to tell one, and it's about you. But go ahead. So if you can think of one.
The funniest story? I got to pick one night when I was playing cheap chess with one of my friends at a local pool room in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Playing Rob Waterbury, and this is when anybody ever knew me, before 2007. This is probably in 2003, 2002 maybe, right after when I got out of college. And I was playing chess with this guy, and before I was kind of like, you know, kind of a rude person. Not really rude, but kind of mouthy and kind of arrogant little kid. And then all of a sudden Chad just said something to me to make me mad. And I said something back to him, and then he got out of the chair and he grabbed me and he hanged me against the wall.
Chad was a pretty big boy.
And man, I was like, oh my God, he literally made me cry. He made me cry, and he said that you need to respect everybody, that no matter who you play, you always respect people around you. And ever since then, this is how I am today. So
he's the one who kind of...
He kind of just teach me.
Made you see that being an asshole is not the way to be.
Reality check.
Yep.
I think we all can fall into that mold. I mean, I think Shane was a little bit miserable, let's say, around that time. When you first start playing, he'd take defeat too hard and sort of like... but I think since you've had that, I think the last 2 or 3 years, I think Shane's become a good professional, a good role model, and definitely the guy to look up to in America. I mean, the young kids should be really watching everything what Shane does, because at the moment, people need... the Americans need a lot of young kids coming through, and Shane's the guy to look up to for his like his sportsmanship and stuff like that.
Can you remember any stories from Chad? Because I remember the first year. I don't know how much you were really around.
It's unbelievable, really. I mean, I meet the guy 2007 for the first time, and I'm thinking, and he just come up to me, and he goes, Daz, you're a killer. I'm thinking, who is this guy? I've never seen him before in my life. He goes, you and Shane got to play, sir. I says, look, I'm not ready. He goes, damn right you're ready, he says. And just little things, like, it made me feel like I've known the guy for years when I've never met the guy before in my life. He's like talking to me as if we're best friends. And then just really had a great relationship after that. And one time we're doing some commentating together, and we're having a lot of fun. And then I just said to him, like, gives a kiss, so he gave me a kiss on the cheek, blah blah, and ever since then, like, whenever we text each other, he says, gives a kiss, pal. So just little funny little things, and whenever I did well, he was one of the first person to message me. When I won a tournament, he'd always message me on Facebook, and there isn't many people who would do that, you know what I mean? Even though I know he was a Shane great fan, I think out of all the Europeans, I think he had a soft spot for me. And I was really, really shocked when he passed away. And one of the biggest losses in the pool world for me, probably the nicest American guy you'll ever meet in your life.
Yeah. No, he was something else. And I know he really loved you and Boise.
Yeah, and it was unique. He had that unique look, that unique personality, the way he spoke, and... I can't remember anyone saying anything bad about him. Yeah, he's going to be sadly missed.
But the story I was talking about, it was funny. It was because, and this, Chad wasn't even there. It was when you played Donnie Mills down in Florida. And is it true that Chad sent you a text and told you to start breaking hard?
Yeah. Yeah.
What happened after you started breaking on?
I don't know what he said, but he sent me a text saying that turn it around, you know.
Because I remember he told me afterwards, because you started breaking hard, and I don't know if he had sent me a text or how it worked out, but I remember he was the one who sent you a text, and that was it. But
he, one thing I know about him, he knows everything about the game. He understands it more than anybody else I've ever seen. So yeah. I mean, he.
He loved the game. He loved the game, and he really loved the players.
I think me and Shane are very popular on Facebook. We might have like 4,000 or 5,000 friends. So you have hundreds of messages of random people saying like, you should be doing this, should be doing that. And you just like ignore a lot of them because they don't really know what they're talking about. But when someone like Chad messages you, you make sure you read it. You know what I mean? And I always replied to him because he always made sense. And there's a lot of guys out there that might not play the game great, but they know what they're talking about.
Well,
And he was definitely one of them.
Yeah, he was a good man, and we're going to miss him. But, there's a lot of good stories out there.
Yeah, and I think if he could watch this match, he'd be very happy, I know.
Oh, I guarantee it.
Whoever wins this match, we'll dedicate this match to him.
Because
I think without him, I don't think there'd be a tar. I mean, yourself.
No, they wouldn't. Absolutely wouldn't.
Yourself and Chad's got a lot to thank for the pool world. Because you're bringing, like, champions, and people are getting to watch us. The best players in the world for like $10-$20. I mean, it's crazy, really.
This is a good question from West Coast for both of you. If you weren't a professional pool player, what would you be doing for a living?
I think when I was younger, I was sort of played to a semi-professional level at soccer, and that was my passion really as a kid. Never got the right opportunities. And then I also boxed. I was also a boxer for 5 years, but didn't really have the art to put the hours in the training. So I would like to think in a different life I would have been a soccer player for like a big team, a big team where you obviously national side, whatever. I mean, that would have been my dream, really. I never envisioned myself working in a warehouse or working in an office or working for someone else. I've always, since the age of 13, 12, I knew I'd be involved in sport, whether it be soccer, boxing, pool. I think I picked pool because it just comes so natural. Come natural, and I could win money in my local pool room. Where at soccer and boxing, you have to, it's, to make money, you got to be right up there at the top level. At pool, even amateurs can make money playing pool. You know what I mean? In any other sport, it's difficult to make money as an amateur. So I think that was my big decision. And obviously, I love pool, and I don't really regret what I'm doing. But if I could have another life, I'd like to have a go playing soccer again.
Shane, what about you, Bob?
I'd be going to school. I went to college at Black Hill State University on the first year after high school. And ever since then, I decided that I want to go play pool. And I just dropped out of school. So if it wasn't for pool, I'd be going to school for something.
What would you want to go to school for?
I decided that I want to go with something outdoors, like game
ice
fishing parks.
Ice fishing.
Yeah. Something with the fish, animals.
So
and
like
stuff.
A park ranger or something like that?
Biology.
Game management.
Yep. Maybe you'd have your own lake or something. Your own lake.
Okay, we got. Let's try to rapid fire a couple of these questions.
Well, you got to ask this one question. I just love it. Have either one of you ever wagered your car that you're driving on a pool game? Do you ever bet pink slips on a car on a pool table?
What was the question?
Did you ever, if you were driving a car and you had a car, did you ever gamble the car in a pool match? it's an interesting question. You know,
yeah,
really,
yeah.
You bet your car before?
No, I never did, but yeah. I would.
Yeah, well, yeah. I don't think you heard the question.
If I'm feeling right,
you said I would.
No, I think I'll leave that one to Shane.
Here's one they got. This is a great question. During, to me, the mental game is the most fascinating part. But during a hill run out. Like, or a real super high pressure game, like in the finals of a tournament and you're on the hill and you're getting ready to win the tournament. As you're doing that final run out, what's going through your head? Is it just fundamentals,
yeah,
don't fuck up, fundamentals, yeah, or are you just laser focused, or are you thinking about anything bigger?
Yeah, for me personally, I just really, I take extra focus, take maybe an extra 5 or 10 seconds over each shot, and make sure my fundamentals are right. The biggest thing is to make sure that my arm stays straight. And I think about these things before I hit it. And then when I get down and thinking, right, keep your head still, whatever you do, just don't move your head. And just keep telling myself, don't miss. I can't miss, you know what I mean? So you sort of like...
Pre-shot routine.
Just pre-shot routine. Then when I get down the shot, don't start thinking negative. I just try and think positive and just... Grit your teeth and make sure you do everything right. Then if you do miss, it's okay. I mean, we all miss under pressure sometimes, but when the ultimate pressure's on, you got to really go through your basics, and then just make sure you beat the demons. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's difficult, but
can you elaborate a little more on that? What do you mean beat the demons?
Well, sometimes you can be hill. Against a player you're never supposed to lose to, you know what I mean? So that adds more pressure because you're thinking, well, if I lose this match to a guy who can't win the tournament, then it's going to really hurt. But if I'm playing someone like Shane or Dennis, I mean, it's a different type of pressure because you're expected it to be ill-hill before the match starts. So you're more prepared for that ill-hill situation because there's always going to be a good chance it's going to go hill-hill, like when the top players play against each other. So you're more mentally prepared for that pressure. Where sometimes you might play a lesser player, it could be a really good player, but you're expected to win on paper. And sometimes you are thinking, oh, I'll probably win this match 11-5, 11-6, which can be the wrong thing to think sometimes. And you're probably not putting yourself under the right preparation before the match. And maybe you're not ready for that situation. And if you're playing bad, then the pressure's worse, because if you're not playing good, and it's a hill-hill match, then it adds a lot more pressure because obviously you have to overcome your mistakes you made in the match, and that can be tough mentally. But on the other hand is that if you're playing really good and it's hill-hill, then the hill-hill situation becomes a lot easier and the demons are not as bad. Mm-hmm. So each type of game and pressure is different.
Shane, same question to you. During the final run out, you know, like when you're running the balls on a hill set or whatever, you know, you're in it. What are you thinking as you run? Like when you were playing the last game against Ronnie Alcano in 2007, do you remember what you were thinking when you were running those last balls out?
Well, I kind of remembered it. I broke and made a ball on a break, and then I see the pattern, I see the table, and I think all I had to do is get to the three ball and I win. So after the three ball, everything's so easy. So that's all I had to think about, is just make sure you get the three ball and you own the tournament. So pretty much I just look at the table pattern, depending on the situation, and just make sure you get there.
Yeah, but I made that mistake. I was in the World 9 Ball this year. I was 12-6 up, and I have the easiest pattern run out you'll ever have to win a match for 13-6. And I overdrew the ball. I like snookered myself. But I was thinking, if I get really good shape on this ball, I'm out. And I probably put too much into one particular shot in that particular instance, and maybe lost a bit of focus, thinking I probably got excited. So like the most pressure I ever felt was a 12-12 game against Lee Yuwen in the World 9 Ball. Mm-hmm. Having a big lead like 12-6, come back to 12-12, and didn't really do a lot wrong besides the racket 12-6. That was the most demons I'll ever have ever in my life. Because I'm telling myself, if I lose this match, I'm jumping off the bridge. So every shot's like a really tough shot. I mean, your arm gets heavy, and that's probably like the most proudest clearance of my career, after thinking I could lose the match from 12-6 to have lost that match. In a World 9 Ball final, you might never get a chance again. I mean, That was tough.
This is an equipment question. What diameter, what shaft diameter and taper do they like the most? Actually, why don't we do this? Shane, won't you put your cue on the table there and I'll take some shots of it? And go ahead and say, just say your cue on the table, like by the spot. There you go. Just set it down on the table. And why don't you tell us about the cue while we're looking at it here?
This is
the bar cue.
I'm trying to think here. This is before, when did I win the U.S. Open 10 ball, Mike?
U.S. Open 10 ball?
Two years ago.
Was it 2 years ago?
2005. Okay, so before 11. The tournament, there was a guy named Tom. He was from my hometown. And he came to Vegas to watch me play. And he saw me that I'm not playing good. And I had another Q-Tech, just similar to this, but it's a different wrap on it. So he walked up to me and he gave me this, right out of the blue.
Yeah, I know that Tom Bordeon or something, right?
Tom Bordeon.
Yeah, I know you're talking about.
Yeah, I know him.
So this is your buddy's.
He plays good.
So yeah, everything's the same. It's Q-Tech, and you can see it's all beat up and all that. So, and Q-Tech R360 shaft.
Everything. That's not a Q you got from Q-Tech. That's your buddy had a Q-Tech and he.
Yeah. So he basically bought the Q-Tech from the Q-Tech.
What about the shaft? He give you the shaft as well?
Yeah, he gave me the shaft and the Q.
How much did you pay him?
No. And I won the tournament. So,
what's the taper and what's the millimeter shaft? And I mean, what pro taper or what is a standard shaft?
I think it's 12.2 right now.
Wow, that's pretty small.
So I mean, every time I use it, it gets wear down a
little
bit.
Yeah.
But I make sure that anytime when I put a new tip on, I make sure they don't touch the shaft. They don't take any dust off of it,
right?
Because it'll go down and it'll go down.
Sure.
But when you leave it where it's at, it don't wear down.
Dash?
Yeah.
Put your cue up here. Let's take a look.
Is that good?
Yeah. And tell us about it. What do you got here?
Well, this is a Icon 2.5. From Predator. I've used since 2007. I use at least one cue a year.
Yeah.
Leave it sit there, so. At least one cue a year. And then each year I like to try a different cue. So I've like sold all my cues to people whoever wants to buy them. But this one here, I got this one in October, just before I play Shane in the Challenger Champions. It's the first time I use this butt. But the shaft is maybe 12 months old, this shaft. As you can see, it's really dirty. But I'm like Shane, I don't like it cleaned. I like it looking dirty, and I don't like anyone touching it because I really like the way it plays.
Right.
So I don't want anyone tinkering with it. I'm just hoping it can last another year before I have to change it. Because I think with 3142 shafts, maybe after every you are supposed to change them after every 2 years. So I'm hoping to get another year out of that shaft. But the butt, they usually have it in leather wrap, but I asked them, I says, I don't like leather wrap because my hand's sweaty and it sticks in my hand, so I wanted the linen wrap because to me it absorbs the sweat a lot better and I can be more loose with my grip because I've got a really loose grip. Out of all the Predator cues I've played with, this is my favourite. This is the best I've felt with a Predator cue, especially this butt. I mean, it hits really nice and the tip, I mean, maybe it's 12.5 at the moment, my my shaft tip. Yeah.
What's it weigh? What's the Q weigh?
It's 19 ounce. And I play with a Kamui Black Soft, maybe 2 years now I've been playing with a Kamui Black Soft, but this tip here, that's maybe, that's a good 12 months old, that tip.
And really?
It's kept,
that's good.
It's kept going good.
Yeah, as much as you play, that's a...
Yeah, I think with me, because I don't have that big power stroke like a lot of the guys, I can get a lot more use.
Take the cue for so I can see the tip towards the camera.
Like this.
There you go. So that's after a year, huh?
Yeah. So I think because I have a shorter stroke than most of the big strokers, I think I get more use out of a tip.
Yeah.
I try and keep the same tip on. Really.
Do you find
I got to change mine every?
Yeah.
Two
but you hit the balls
every 2 months. Wow.
Could I break with this?
You break with it too. You were using a break cue at one time. You just don't do that.
Yeah. Anymore? Sometimes I got to break with my breaking cue, depending on the table conditions and stuff. Yeah. You know.
Because do you find that as your tip matures and it wages, it starts changing the way the stick plays?
Well, this is the best tip I've ever had on. I mean, usually I've maybe every 4 months I change a tip or 5 months, but. What's his name? Joe Blackburn.
Yep, Blackburn, you're right.
He put this on for me at the Derby, mm-hmm. straight after the Derby.
So it's almost a year old. I've had it on since, 11 months.
And there's a guy from Germany who puts really good tips on. There's only three guys I let Mike put tip on for me, and Joe's the best guy in America, in my opinion.
By far.
I mean, there's a lot of other good guys. I ain't knocking no one, but I mean.
Yeah, Joe's, and Joe is a hell of a player, too.
Yeah, but the good thing with Joe is that when he puts it on, I know he'd give it back the way I want it.
Yep.
And he knows not to touch my shaft. Where one time I give the shaft to a guy, he's like done all this with it, and it's come back, it was like sandpaper. So yep. I had to get rid of the shaft.
Right. They can. So, a guy putting on a tip can ruin the shaft.
Yeah. I didn't even ask him to touch the shaft, and he's like messing around with it. And I told him now, I said, look, don't touch my shaft.
Okay.
It's important.
Interesting.
I think the main two things of a pool player is the shaft and the tip. People don't realize how important the tip is. The tip plays a big part. If you get a good feel for the tip, then you put the cue all the way you want. That's the key, isn't it, really? And play, especially playing when you spin.
Yeah.
Shane has got a big stroke, so an harder tip suits him.
That was one of the debates on some of the people were saying that. You know, a lot of people that well, Shane's break and blah blah blah. But a couple of people were very astute and said, "Well, Darren has that nice compact stroke.
Yep.
He does it. It only as big as it needs to be."
Well, that's why a soft tip suits me. I think any amateur pool player shouldn't play with an hard tip because, like, the softer the tip, it helps them to draw the cue ball back.
Yep.
Where Shane played with a soft tip, it'd be drawing the cue ball back too much. I mean, it'd be crazy. You know what I mean?
Yep.
But with an hard tip, he has that nice control. Nice, he gets through the cue ball. But I mean, it suits the way he strokes the ball. Someone like Chris Mellon, he'd be not very good with a soft, I don't think. Them big strokers.
Yeah.
But I think Ralph, and people like Nick Vandenberg, I think we all like soft tips.
Really? Yeah, years ago everybody used to use those Elk Masters.
Efren
was using for a while, and they were soft tip.
I used Elks until 2 years ago.
They were standard for like 40 years.
Yeah. I couldn't get a consistent elk.
No.
Sometimes you get a good one, sometimes a bad one, and then eventually you think, screw it.
Well, they're not a layered tip. I think your layered tips are a lot better for consistency.
Yeah, these Kamuis are amazing. I mean, out of all the tips in the world, Kamuis are by far the best layered tips.
Well, then we've got the right sponsor.
Yeah, and you're sponsored by
good.
Me. Well,
I just wanted to clear that up,
Where's my sponsor?
He'll be here this weekend.
Oh, he's
I'll introduce
guy.
You.
I like him.
Yeah, John.
Oh, John's coming.
Yeah. Any predictions about the match? Now the match starts. It's Tar 30, and it starts Friday at 4 o'clock Pacific, 7 o'clock Eastern. Race to 25 one day, then Saturday we race to 25. Are we going to have a third day?
Yeah. Hopefully for the crowd. I mean, for the spectators at home, it'd be good if it was a third day. But obviously Shane wants to win 2-0. I'd like to win 2-0. We'll just take each day as it comes and. Try and win the first day, that's all you can do.
Yeah.
but I'm just really excited to play, and because it's been maybe three years since I played a tar match, so I feel as though I've sort of waited too long to come back and play, and I really appreciate the invite from yourself and Justin and Tar.
Hey, we're happy to have you.
I mean, I was probably pre-played a couple of times last year, but the schedule didn't work out, but I'm really happy that I get the chance to play Shane. I think only Dennis and Shane, they're the two guys I want to play the most.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, you want to, in my opinion, Shane and Dennis at this moment in time are the two guys to beat in the world. So you only can really judge yourself against them guys at this moment in time. And, I mean, if I lose, there's no disgrace. And but I know if I play my game, I have a chance of causing an upset, according to the American fans.
You know, we want to... Justin and I have been talking. We got to get one of your teammates over here. I want to see Chris Milling duke it out with somebody.
Yeah, we've talked about maybe me and Chris against Shane and Johnny, or me and Kyle against Shane and Johnny.
Well, that'd be interesting.
Yeah, that'd be good. Yeah.
Now, the winner of this plays Mike DeShane. Is that correct, Mr.
That
Justin?
Depends. We have to see. Daz, we have to. We have a scheduling problem.
Right.
If he wins.
Yeah.
But right. We'll, at some point, we'll figure that out.
Yeah. Okay.
Shane, what's your prediction?
I know Darren playing good now, so I mean, it's gonna be tough. So I can't really say what's gonna be. So I'm not really happy with my break right now. So I gotta say it's probably gonna go on 3 days, but I'm gonna try to get on 2 days.
What's gonna be the big package? Just out of curiosity, people like packages. Anybody run a 6 or 7? It's happened.
Yeah.
So this is new cloth.
Was it a race to 100 when it happened?
No.
Wow.
No. Shane ran 7 or 8 and out on Alex the first day, and then came back and ran like 2 or 3 the next day, I think. And then an 8-ball, he ran a 6 or 7 pack. And but
I think 4 or 5 would be really good on this table.
Yeah.
I think that'd be the average.
I think I can get.
He might run 10. I mean, I'll be happy. I'll be very happy with a 5-pack.
Oh yeah,
but he might run 10.
I think I can get more than 6.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure there'll be.
I've been practicing on this table the last couple of days, and
yeah,
I think I ran like 4 rests at one time.
Yeah. I mean, when I practiced the other day, I broke good on this table, so hopefully it'll break the same.
Yeah.
But I need to try and get some balls here. I need to try and fill them up a little bit.
Well, I tell you what, guys, we've been on for an hour and a half now. Let's go ahead and wrap this up. Darren or Shane, is there anything you guys want to say to anybody out there?
Yeah, just which camera are you looking at?
Right here.
Just like to say to the UK guys, tune in. Make sure you watch. Make sure you support me in the chat. And I'd just like to thank my sponsors. It's okay to mention my sponsors?
Absolutely.
C-System.com. Yaling Tables and Predator Qs, thanks for your support as always, and hopefully we get a lot of exposure from this match, and the best man will win. I'm on this table, whoever plays the best will definitely win the match. There'll be no complaining about roles and stuff like that, so just enjoy the game.
I know all my friends are watching right now, and I know they're going to be watching this week. So you guys are going to enjoy the match this week. I want to say thank you to Q-Tech, my sponsor. And we'll see you guys this week.
Okay.
All right. Cool. Well, we're looking forward to it. Justin, you wanted to give everybody the...
Yeah, I just want to run through our sponsors one more time. I want to thank... just running in order here. We'll go in no particular order, I should say. OBQs, who's been with us almost since the beginning. Want to thank Royce for sticking around with us. We'll see them out here this weekend. Kamui Tips, who will also be here this weekend. All the sponsors want. I think they sponsored so they can get a seat. They want to make sure they can sweat this. Mm-hmm. But Kamui, as you heard, we'll see if we can't get Darren a sponsorship out of the deal. And then Kurzweils. I'm telling you guys, it's amazing stuff. It really is, and it's fast shipping, and it's awesome. So check that out. I'm on Facebook, on my page, and on the TAR page, there's a little ad up there that's got a special he's got going on now. It's $50 shipped for a bunch of stuff, and then you get 10% off if you mention TAR. So go check that out, and I'll put it on the web page as well. And then we've got Q Sports International, which we've got the what's the dates on the Swanee?
February 23rd and 24th in L.A.
And then right after that is the U.S. Bar Table Championship.
Right.
And TAR will be streaming the U.S. Bar Table Championships.
And I want to say a special thanks to Kurzweil, because, you know, it excites me when we get people outside the industry to sponsor pool. Now all we need is Cadillac and Coke and Nike, and we're off to the races.
And the MGM.
Yeah. Well, I think this is about it. So everybody tell your friends about the match. It's Friday, TAR 30. And you can go to theactionreport.com, and that's where you can do all the business. And Justin will give you your code, and you'll be able to watch some of the best pool known to man.
Yep. And thanks again for everybody watching the podcast tonight, and for everybody who's helped promote this on Facebook by sharing the links, things like that. That helps a great deal. Really appreciate it, and hope you keep it up all weekend. And thanks a lot, guys. Let's wrap it up, I guess.
Yeah, that's it.
Say goodnight.
Good night, y'all. Thank you very much, and thanks to Shane and Darren. Thank you very much.
Thank you.